This day when we celebrate the achievement of these graduates, the Oakdale class of 2015, these seniors have worked hard to reach this place, and we congratulate you for what you've done to get here. You are exceptional people, and that is so evident in so many ways. You're sharp, you have many gifts, and you've received tools for success here at Oakdale. In a little while, we'll celebrate and recognize the staff who have, and the teachers individually. This is appropriate because as this diploma today that you receive speaks very specifically to the academic work that you've done. But the significance of the day goes far beyond the credits that you receive and that you've earned. You've learned how to live in community, in a close-knit community. It's probably very different than any other community you've been in, and maybe different than the one you're leaving here to enter into. And to realize success here has demonstrated an ability to adapt, to learn how to live in community, and that's going to serve you well throughout your entire lives. It'll make you not only a valuable employee for the work that you do, but also for the way that you know how to work with others. So not just your skills in doing things, but skills in being with other people. So what you'll receive today in these blue folders represents a lot more than just your academic work. It represents the success in living in community. And people will recognize things about you. They won't know where it came from, but they'll know that you are people who are exceptional in a lot of ways. They won't know that it's because of Oakdale, but we will. At this time, I want to take a moment to welcome some of our guests. The success of these graduates is absolutely shared with many others in this room. Parents, family members, teachers, deans, board members, financial and prayer partners, all of you here today who are part of watching, those even watching on the live stream video over the internet. I want to recognize our Board of Trustees, a tremendously talented and dedicated group of people who pray for Oakdale and spend their time working, thinking, giving to Oakdale, providing overall direction and governance and leadership. We really have a great board. And they're committed to the cause of Oakdale Christian Academy. They're committed to the cause of Christ, as expressed here at Oakdale Christian Academy. I want to ask our board members to please stand so that we can recognize you. Please stand. You know, I was noting right before this service, where people came from to be here today. Now, just simply representing the graduates, we have family members,
the graduates
from Kyrgyzstan, from Nigeria, from Ohio, from Rwanda, Winchester, Kentucky, Oklahoma, and Chicago. I want to ask any family members or out-of-town guests who've come specifically to recognize the graduates, I want you to ask you to please stand and be recognized. Staff, and they're a tremendous group of people, and I want to ask, you know, they give so much to our graduates, to all of our students on a daily basis, day in, day out, month in, month out, year in, year out, and they are reflected in many ways in our graduates. I want to ask, first of all, because we're talking about an academic institution, if you're a teacher at Oakdale, I want you to please stand and be recognized. Just teachers. I want to ask for rest of the Oakdale staff to please stand and remain standing. And I want to add to that number, we have several former staff members here. Anyone who has served on our staff and is here, I want you to please stand as well. It's always an honor to have alumni on campus, and anyone who is a former student or a graduate of Oakdale, I'd like you to please stand here today. And I want to welcome to the stage the chair of our Board of Trustees, Dr. Joseph James, and our commencement speaker, Cedric Peerman. Please stand as we welcome you. And now I'll ask the Oakdale Choir to come. They're gonna share a couple of numbers with us. The choir is under the direction of Betty Johnston. Choir, go ahead and make your way up here. Paul and Betty Johnston have been full-time volunteers this last semester, have been really a blessing to our ministry, and we've really enjoyed having the choir as part of the expression of their involvement. So they will share two songs with us, "We Can Build a Bridge" and "No Other Gods."
Sometimes if we rose, we'll twist until it. It is our pleasure every year to honor some of our students who have distinguished themselves in various areas, and one of those areas is the Anderson Academic Award. The Anderson Academic Award was created in honor of Myrtle Anderson, who was a missionary to Japan and an early principal at Oakdale, who had set a high standard of academic excellence that we strive to continue and to expand on from year to year. The recipient of the Anderson Academic Award is a student that has distinguished themselves by reaching beyond just what is placed before them to grasp the knowledge that lies beyond and draw it into their learning. They are an asset to their classmates. They are a challenge to their teachers, because we have to keep our academic standards high in order to challenge these students. This year, our recipient of the Anderson Academic Award was Amarachi Ndukwe.
The O'Connor Christian Service Award is named after Elizabeth O'Connor, the founder of Oakdale, who moved into this area to reach out to people who did not have access to education, and she had a vibrant testimony and just shined the light of Christ in this area for many years. And so we give this award every year to someone who has a clear testimony, who reaches out to others, and who follows in that example of Christ-like service. And this year's recipient is a young lady who comes to us from the ministry of the Happy Church, and we partner with each week, and many of our students go in and serve there, and this young lady has just come out of this culture where she serves and ministers to the students around her and the young kids who are there. And so the recipient of the O'Connor Christian Service Award this year is Abby Howard. The Wilson Work Award is named after Alex Wilson, who donated this property that we are still on, and was a very hard worker and just set an example that continues to be part of the program here. We value hard work at Oakdale. Our students work hard in their classes, and they stay quite busy. If that was all they had to do, they would be very busy. They also work hard in their dorms, and they help do dishes, as do our staff. They all do job training. As you walk around campus, you'll notice how nice it looks. It's beautiful right now, and that is much of that is because our students have been working hard to prepare and get it ready. This room that we're in looks as nice as it has ever looked because our recipient today has had her crew down here working hard. Hours that were not slated for job training, she's been down here and has got other people down here to make this look very nice for graduation. She takes pride in her work and helps others do the same. She's a very hard worker. She has won this award multiple times. So again this year, this will be her last time earning it because she's graduating, but the recipient of the Wilson Work Award is Liberty Guinness.
We have some special recognitions to make, and I'd like to invite Irvin Allen of the Kiwanis Club to come and bring a special citizenship award presentation.
To the members of the graduating class, permit me to remind you that the scriptures tell us a good person's steps are directed by the Lord. That is, they are orchestrated, they're in fact choreographed by the Lord. He will never lead you wrong, and if you follow Him all the days of your life, you will never go wrong. Kiwanis is a civic organization that loves to build and delights in building communities and parts of communities. It adopted six objects, they're called, in Denver, Colorado, in its convention there in 1920. Those six objects remain in place today and have never changed. I would like to share those with you right now. The first, to give primacy to the human and spiritual rather than to the material values of life. Number two, to encourage the daily living of the golden rule in all human relationships. Number three, to promote the adoption and the application of higher social, business, and professional standards. Number four, to develop by precept and example a more intelligent, aggressive, and serviceable citizenship. Number five, to provide through Kiwanis clubs a practical means to form enduring friendships, to render altruistic service, and to build better communities. And number six, to cooperate in creating and maintaining that sound public opinion and high idealism which make possible the increase of righteousness, justice, patriotism, and goodwill. The Jackson Kiwanis Club delights in recognizing good citizenship, and it pleases me to announce that this year's award goes to Isaiah Johnson. Consists of a certificate and a check for $100.
I would like to ask Jason and Melissa Johnston to join me at the platform. Let's have a little applause while they come on. Johnstons came to us 5 years ago from Mississauga, Ontario, and they filled several important roles. Jason came and served at first doing some teaching and as a dorm parent, and now if you'd ask him, he's a full-time teacher and technology coordinator for the academic program. If you ask him what he does, he says, well, mostly fun stuff. So he teaches the robotics and coding and gaming and computers and stuff like that. The fact of the matter is that he makes his classes fun, but he makes them challenging, and the students love being in his classes with him. Yesterday, for the junior high graduation, we saw him take a bunch of junior high students and turn them into, it was amazing. I don't even know how to describe it, but it was a musical ensemble, and it was really, really great. So he and he has had a big part in our worship team and helped with a lot of things with technology for PR. Melissa has come as dorm parent, has worked as our health services coordinator, and recently she's assumed a valuable role as consultant for aesthetics on campus as we plan for the girls' dorm and she's been very busy on the grounds, and a lot of what you see on the campus here has a lot to do with her work there. So we want to recognize him for 5 years of service with this 5-year service award. They both say to in recognition of a significant life investment in the mission of leading teenagers to lives of learning, service to others, and loving God, presented with gratitude of Oakdale's co-workers, board members, supporters, students, and alumni. Joined our staff.
And he came as, well, he already knew a little bit about Oakdale. Some of you may know the story. But he came back from college and joined the staff, working on our Character Quest Spudazzo program for a number of years, doing some work as a dorm parent for a while, doing activities director, teaching, and now Dean of Students. He knows Oakdale, knows our program, and as a member of our administrative committee, gives great counsel, and I'm really pleased to work with him. 20 years he's given to this ministry, and Oakdale has really benefited from it. So I give him this 20-year service award. Logistically, can we do this? Stan Welton and Gloria Welton to the platform. Stan and Gloria came to us 6 years ago, and we had a need for a business manager, and I was at a church gathering, like a multi-conference kind of a gathering, and I had a couple of minutes to give an announcement. I said, we're looking for a business manager, and he came up to me, and boy, what a great thing. In retrospect, that has been, what a great day that was, and all the days that have come through that Stan and Gloria have come and joined our staff. And Stan has taken a pastorate position here in the conference, and we'll be leaving. This is actually his last official day, and I just want to comment first on Stan, that the kind of work that he does, the kind of gifts that he brings, multi-talented, multi-faceted, multi-dimensional person who cares about everything from the sound in the church, doing videography, doing Excel spreadsheets like I've never seen, didn't know even possible, to the excellence that he's brought and he's worked toward in the business office, doing the IT work for the campus, to supervising the maintenance staff and the kitchen staff, and the kinds of work that he's done, like if you notice the Anderson Hall entrance that we put on the other side, the big brick thing, Stan was really the architect for that. He put together the plan and put it into action, and that's just the kind of thing that he's been able to add to this campus. Just really, really great kind of things he's done, and he works really hard. You can imagine with all those things, he works really hard. Gloria has many things. She's done tutoring, she's done teaching. She has taken on the library, adopted it, and made it something that's, it hasn't been in years anyway, and it is, the library is in such a great place. Whoever comes in next as librarian will be so grateful for the work that she's done, that she did to get it to where it is now. So we are awarding the Tuller Dedication Award to Stan and Gloria Welton. It's given to people who have given a minimum of 5 years and whose service here has really, really, really made a difference. And so this is in recognition of service at Oakdale Christian Academy, characterized by transformational service, a love for students, and a Christ-like example, presented with tremendous gratitude. Please come to the platform. She is our salutatorian, and she's prepared remarks for us this morning.
Hey guys, can you believe we're finally graduating? It seems insane. I know for some of you, your diploma is the first thing that the school's ever given you to read that you actually look forward to reading. you should look forward to it. Graduating is a big deal. I'm sure your families are all very proud of you. Seriously, I can't imagine how relieved they are that you actually made it. This is a great time to ask for money. Here, at the end of your high school career, in the beginning of a new part of your journey through life, I couldn't think of a more appropriate topic than knowledge. The speaker a while ago talked about failure, and I believe that the ultimate result of failure should be knowledge. Learn from your mistakes and all that. I'm sure at least some of you have been expecting me to bring up knowledge because it's something I value extremely highly. In this day and age, every single one of us has a fountain of knowledge available to us. Some people drink from it, and some people just gargle. The world is full of people who gargle. They scratch the surface of all there is to know, all there is to learn, and then they're satisfied. They dip the tips of their toes in the water and think they have accomplished some wondrous feat. They gargle, and my wish for you is that you drink, and drink deeply. Never be satisfied with what you know, because there's always so much more. There is no end to education, at least there shouldn't be. And I know some of you aren't going to be happy to hear that, because you're looking forward to stop learning, at least for a little while. But life's not like that. You can't read a book, ace a test, and pass life and be done. It's just not how it works. The whole of life, from the moment you're born to the moment you die, is a process of learning. And it should be. What would life be without learning? As babies, we begin the process. Our parents spend the first 2 years of our lives teaching us how to walk and talk, the next 22 years telling us to sit down and shut up. That's where it all begins. We learn to move and make ourselves understood, and from then on it just gets better. We go from babbling nonsense like Julianne to giving speeches. We go from stumbling or crawling around to playing volleyball, basketball. We learn new ways of expressing ourselves, and we become more and more unique. As babies, pretty much all babies are the same. They say the same things, they can barely walk, they can barely move, they look like potatoes. All babies are the same. But now, we have our own goals and dreams. We are now young men and women, and it's all because of learning. Mahatma Gandhi once said, "Live as if you were to die tomorrow. Learn as if you were going to live forever." It's a good quote to live by, because above all, you must live. Living is the best thing you can possibly do, and quite possibly the rarest. Most people never accomplish anything beyond existing. And my wish for you is that you don't exist, you live.
Faculty and staff, family and guests, and fellow students, especially my seniors. Well, it is a big honor to be standing in front of you this morning, and I couldn't have done it without all of your support, directly or indirectly. But I want to give special thanks to some special people. Mr. Coates, with English, it's been a great time to have you as my teacher and improving my skills in English. Mr. J, loving me and caring, though he hides it in his hatred. Mrs. Johnston Sr. with her patience with me in piano. Miss Cook and Miss Johnson for being amazing beings and listening to me and giving me good advice. Mr. Zink for his time and teaching me how to be healthy and take care of myself. And Mrs. Wills, who is the best teacher you've ever had in life. Though hard, but it's okay. It's for your good. Okay. But mostly, I want to thank the Murrays and the Waltons. They have had a huge impact in my life, and I'm absolutely sure I wouldn't have survived without them. They have pushed me to do my best, and they have taught me to love my failures in order to be better. They have shown me how to keep going through hardships when life is so determined and knocking me down. I am really thankful for that. Thank you. While all of these people have been influential in my life, my biggest role models have been my parents. Can you wave, Mom and Dad? Thankful I am to be born from them. I am proud and honored to be called their child. They are the pillars of my life. I don't know what I would do without them, considering the fact I wouldn't even exist without them. My father is the perfect example of a hard worker. He persisted and persevered in giving us a good life and a great education, which is why I'm standing in front of you today. I don't know much about his life, but I know some. I know he had to work through high school to be able to survive. I know sometime in our life we had no electricity and used all burners for light. But look at where I am right now. Not only me, but my other two siblings here. My father is my role model for never, ever giving up. My mother. Man, oh, that lady, she's perfect. I don't know, like, everything she has gone through, having me 9 months in her womb, oh, with complications. It's a long story. If you want, you can ask her, she's gonna tell you. And then she had like some losses in her life, like her job. For an intellectual woman like that, it's really hard. And then the four kids after me, more work. But we still turned out pretty good. My mother is my definition of strength. She is the pillar of the family, the light that makes us all happy and joyful. She's just the best mother. And in recognition of their hard work to get me here, I want you all to stand and clap your loudest for these two amazing people. I was blessed. Work very hard, but at the same time, play, which means have fun very hard. Back in my country, I used to either do well or fail. Now, some people might not believe me because they've seen me only succeed, but you can ask my parents, they remember the failures. Until the day, all I did was just fail. I tried, tried, and tried, but no matter what, it wouldn't work out. I was ready to give up, but guess what, when you have African parents, especially the kind I've got, there's no option of giving up. So then, my last term in Rwanda, back in my country, was significantly better. I came here, they put me back in my sophomore year. It was the real test. I had been a senior in my country, so when I came back, I was a sophomore. I cried for days. I screamed. I was angry. My friends, they can remember that they didn't know what to do. The staff didn't know what to do either. And my parents shared my pain, but as always, kept pushing. One morning I woke up and I said my goal, excellence, no matter what. I had failed to myself, but I was making my goal to show them that I was capable, and they would be so amazed, and they would ask themselves, why didn't we let her go on? And I did. I've been on honor roll since I've been here. I am a member of the National Honor Society. And recently, one of my favorite teachers was Mrs. Ross, said, you are an anomaly. I had finally made my point and excelled in achieving my goal. Through the process, I still had failures, a lot of them. But like I told you, I learned to rejoice and learn from them. When I succeed without failure, I think it's fake. I'm not as proud as I should be. After failing a major test once, my previous principal, Mrs. Kratzer, sent me this card encouraging me to keep on going and an article from National Geographic that proved how failure was the road to success. And this can be largely proven just by looking at the people who are greatly admired now and successful to this day. Starting, let's say, sports, Michael Jordan. He's the king of basketball. He has made his legacy. And he once said, I've missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I've lost almost 300 games. 26 times, I've been trusted to take the game-winning shot and missed. I have failed over and over and over again in my life. And this is why I succeed. If we go to science, Thomas Edison, the inventor of light bulb, went through bazillions of failures and finally made his statement, I have not failed. I've just found 10,000 ways that won't work. Albert Einstein, who was considered unintelligent and was kicked out of school because of that, ended up as the father of the physics law, E equals MC squared. If we go to technology, Steve Jobs, founder of Apple, he never finished school, but look at where his legacy is right now. He is the most popular entrepreneur in technology ever. If we go to politics, Abraham Lincoln, one of the American presidents and my favorite, ran for different positions in the government, but always failed until he won the biggest one as a president. If we go to medicine, Ben Carson, who was poor and had difficulties in learning. He was so driven in his goals that he ended up being the first neuroscience doctor to separate twins conjoined at the head. I would go on with this list because there are a lot of people out there who failed and failed, but finally understood that not giving up plus failure lead to great success. So for my fellow seniors today, I know we're about to start the life. Right now, it's the life. But I want to tell you that failure is the main road to success. If you don't give up, life will not knock you down. Like Thomas Watson Sr. said, the founder of IBM, if you want to increase your success rate, double your failure rate. To the remaining students, I'm going to repeat what I've told you and repeat it the whole time. Success seems to be connected with action. Successful people keep moving. They make mistakes, but they don't quit. Because the harder you fall, the higher you bounce. And to everyone else in this room, like Colin Powell, former US Secretary of State, said, there are no secrets to success. It is the result of preparation, hard work, and learning from failure. To finish, I'm going to tell you why my favorite quote has evolved to. Maybe some of you will find it as useful as I have. Who can remember what it was? Work hard, play hard. Now, the new one is, the goal is not only to work hard and play hard, but to make your goal, your work, and your play indistinguishable. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our speaker this morning is Cedric Peerman, running back for the Cincinnati Bengals since 2010. Now, you can go online and find a lot of great statistics about the things that he's done. I wanted to share just a little bit about the privilege I've had in visiting with him a few times that he's been on campus, and we've had a few moments together. And my spirit has soared to see that he is hungry. He's a man who's hungry for God, a man seeking to live for Jesus. Peerman is ordained as an associate minister in the Mount Zion First African Baptist Church in Charlottesville, Virginia. He's known as the Running Reverend. Cedric's wife, Hagar, is with us today. Hagar will begin medical school at the University of Cincinnati. And Cedric just signed a new contract with Cincinnati Bengals, which helps ensure that they will be with us in the neighborhood for a good long time here. We met Cedric and Hagar when Hannah, Hagar's sister, enrolled here at Oakdale in just this last semester or so. And it's been a joy to be in partnership with that family. Earlier this morning, Cedric was elected to the Oakdale Christian Academy Board of Trustees. So he's one of my bosses. Take it easy, Uncle Cedric. Help me welcome the Running Reverend Cedric Peerman.
Well, it is indeed a great honor and a privilege to be here. From where I'm from, like, people don't grow up to do commencement addresses and to go on and play in the NFL and do those types of things. So I just stand before you just extremely humbled and honored and just thrilled out of my mind to be here and to be able to celebrate with you guys on your graduation, and to be able to celebrate with the parents, family, and faculty. It really just makes me so overjoyed to be here, and just to see how far people have come. You graduates, you guys should be jumping out your seats. You gotta stand and give your family a little bit of love, a little bit of hand clap. Come on, stand up. And everybody else can stand up and give these guys. Before we get started, let's just have a word of prayer if you don't mind. Well, Father, thank you so much. I know that there are many other people that I can think of who work at the school, who could be up here and speaking and do a much better job than me. But I thank you that you've given me the opportunity to speak to these graduates, to these future graduates, and to the parents and family and faculty that are here. I thank you for that, Father, and I pray that you would slide me out of the way and that you would clearly see me, be clearly heard. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, today I want to talk about a life worth living, a story worth telling. And the reason I want to talk about that is because as graduates and even future graduates here today, as you will be leaving this place, and some of the future graduates will be leaving sort of for the summer, maybe you're staying. But wherever you are, I think you need to be reminded of what kind of life is worth living. No matter who you are here today, no matter how old you are, your circumstances, we all here have a story. Your life is a story. And
Some stories here today are a lot older than some other stories, so if you're in the older, you know, part, then the younger people are headed there, so don't worry. But regardless, we all are here, have lives, and thus far, however long you've been on this earth, your life has told a story. Your story, your life, tells us who you are, where you come from, what you've done, the consequences of your decisions, maybe even the people you've helped or the people you've hurt. More importantly, your story, in my opinion, tells us about how you've lived, either for the honor of God and Christ or not. So with that being said, I want to share with you a little bit of my story, a little bit about my life and where I come from and what God did in me. I grew up in a two-parent home. My parents took us to church every Sunday, and I was always involved in youth groups and Bible studies and vacation Bible schools and all of those different types of things. And I remember at the age of 10 or 11, I professed to be a believer in Jesus. I wanted to give my life to Jesus, and I was baptized. And if you would have asked someone about me, what type of person was I back then at the age of 10? They would have said something like, I think, you know what, Cedric's a really good person. He's successful, he's good at sports, he's smart, he gets good grades in school. He looks like he's got a lot going for him. So I grew up with this sort of attitude that I'm a pretty good person. And I always remember sort of believing that my goodness, me being a good person, I didn't think I did much wrong. I wasn't a thief, or at least I didn't think I was. I wasn't a liar, at least I didn't think I was. I wasn't an adulterer, or at least I didn't think I was. I sort of believed that sort of my goodness plus my belief in Jesus would get me to heaven. That was my ticket to heaven. Sort of believed that. So I would emphatically declare to anybody here from age 10 to 21 that I was a Christian. That I was a believer, a genuine believer in Jesus. But as I look back on things now, I basically sort of lived my life how I wanted to live. I sort of did what I wanted. I just remember I never really wanted to go to church. My parents basically had to drag us to church, as the old saying goes. I never really wanted to be bothered with God all that much. I sort of wanted it on my own terms to do it when I wanted to do it. And I just remember not really being concerned about how I was really living my life. I really wasn't concerned with the wrong things that I had done in my life. Really wasn't concerned with the sin in my life. And I was comfortable with my life. You know, I had things going for me. I was good at football, good at sports. People would applaud me. My name would be in the papers. I would even get interviewed by television stations in high school and all of these different types of things, and even on into college. I had what you would deem a very successful life. But also looking back on things now, the evidence of my life really suggested, you know, that I was just basically a hypocrite. I wasn't a Christian because I was involved in a relationship, and I remember this being an ungodly relationship. I remember struggling with images on television and on the internet, things that I would go and look at. I was addicted to those things. Why do I tell you these things? Things that now have left wounds and have left hurts share these things to you so that you might see how great God is. How great He is. And so I remember going, I went to the University of Virginia on a full scholarship, and I had these great plans of how my life was going to go. You know, I graduated high school. I had all of these successes, and I was so happy and scared. You guys might be scared. Going off to a new place. You know, I only went an hour and a half away to college, but Gladys, Virginia to Charlottesville, Virginia, that was like going from like the country to New York City or something like that in my eyes. And so I was excited, but I was thrilled. And all of my plans for college, for football, you know what? They never really worked out how I planned for it to go. And I remember playing football. Football was a lot about me and about my success and about how I can get ahead. Football for me wasn't something that I used to honor God. It was something that I used to bring glory and honor to myself. As I look back on it now, football was like this huge idol in my life. An idol of comfort, an idol of pleasure, something that I look to for identity. And also this relationship that I was involved in, this was another idol in my life. An idol of comfort, an idol of pleasure. And it ended up happening that this relationship ended. And it ended up happening that half of my football season in 2007 was cut short by an injury. And during that time of my life, those were my two idols in my life. The two things that I hung on to, a relationship and football, and God destroyed them. He took them out of my life, at least for a time. And I just remember in 2007, at the end of that year, December 2007, I heard about Jesus. Now, I've heard about, up to that point, I've sat in church. I've sat in Bible studies. I've talked to people about Jesus. I knew things about Jesus, but this time was different. Upon hearing about Jesus, this time was completely different. I heard about what it really meant to be a Christian. What it meant to live life in following Jesus. And never before had I been so crushed. That day I realized that I wasn't a Christian, even though I had spent 11, 12 years of my life proclaiming to be one. As I look back on things now, I think about how prideful I was to think that my own goodness before God was enough to enter into those great gates. I think about that a lot. If I had have died during that time, I would have gone to heaven thinking to be allowed in. Yet Jesus would have said, "Depart from me, you worker of lawlessness." I think about that a lot. But I heard about Jesus. And never before had I been cut so deep. Again, I realized that I wasn't a Christian. I wasn't a follower of Jesus. I didn't have forgiveness of my sins. I didn't have eternal life. I realized that I was separated from God. Even though I claimed to know Him. And I claimed to live for Him. I remember I would even say things about God. Thanking God. On television and in the newspapers. But my heart was far from Him, even though I honored Him with my lips. But ever since hearing about Jesus that day, my life hasn't been the same. And it's been by God's grace that my life has changed. Things that I never wanted anything to do with, I began to love. People, other Christians I never really wanted to hang around with or be with became my best friends. It wasn't like I like turned over a new leaf or like pulled up my bootstraps or girded up my loins to try to do better. Like God changed me in my heart.
Preach it.
And allowed me to make these changes. It was him. I give him all the glory for that. So that's a little bit of my story thus far. I came to a point in my life by God's grace where he showed me that the life that I was living was not worth living. But he didn't leave me there. He also showed me a different way of living, a life that's really worth living. Even though I had all of these successes, all of these things going for me, I was like, you've put these things over me. This is not the life that's worth living. Having fame, being the best at whatever. In God's view, that this isn't the life that's worth living. This isn't all that there is. I think Mark 8, 34 through 38 sums it up best. It says, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. This is Jesus here. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Just the other day, I came across this passage. And I just had to ask myself just a question. I asked myself the way that God had changed my life, everything, how I was living, how I was going about my life, living for Christ. Is all of that really worth it? I mean, why not? After you leave here, why not just... You've been for 4 years, however many years. So many rules here, right? So many things that you can't do that you really want to do. Sorry, current students. So many things that you've grumbled at, complained at. So many different things that you're like, why? Come on, really, why? Right? We've all done that. What Jesus is saying here, is this really worth it? Living this life, is it really worth it? This is what he's asking. He's saying, deny yourself. He's saying, not your will, but his will. But not what you want to do or what you love or what you like to do, but his will over all of that. He says, take up your cross. A cross, which is a symbol of suffering. This isn't like a happy-go-lucky thing. This isn't something that's cool, even. The symbol of suffering and shame and humiliation and trial and difficulty. Then he says, follow me. Now granted, he had just told his disciples that he was going to be killed. He was going to suffer many things, be rejected and killed. And then he says, follow me. Is it all really worth it? Is this the life that's worth living? Then if that's not enough, he says, he wants me to lose my life for his sake and for the sake of his message, the good news. I mean, you probably would say something, my life? He wants me to lose my life? My life is the most precious thing to me. He wants me to give it away makes me feel good. He's saying here, he's saying you must value me above and beyond your own dreams, your desires, your emotions, your family, your sports, your school, having fun, your reputation, your friends. He says, value me above and beyond even your own life. I asked myself, I had to ask myself, is all of this really worth it? I mean, why not eat, drink, and be merry and go out and do whatever you want to do? Why not? Is it all really worth it, what he's asking here? I asked myself, is all of this worth it? Then it sort of just came to me. And, you know, I kind of concluded, I kind of heard myself say, you know what, look at who Jesus is and what he's done for you. Then I thought about Jesus. I thought about what he's done. I thought about how he was born to a virgin, the Virgin Mary. How when John baptized him, there was this great voice from heaven that said, "This is my son with whom I'm well pleased." I thought about when he healed blind Bartimaeus and when he spotted Zacchaeus in the sycamore tree. I contemplated on how he raised Lazarus from the dead. And he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to me. No one comes to the Father except through me." I thought about these things. I thought about how he was betrayed by his own followers and handed over into the hands of evil people. I thought about how they beat him till he was unrecognizable and how they nailed him to a cross. I thought about how he took my sins, all of my deeds, all of my thoughts, all of my wicked intentions upon himself on the cross, and he bore God's wrath in my place. As if he had actually committed those sins, those wicked things. I thought about these things. I thought about how he didn't stay dead, but he rose from the grave the third day. I thought about these things. I thought about how he ascended and how God said to him, "Sit at my right hand. Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." I thought about all of these things. And after all of this, I concluded the very least thing that I could do is deny myself, take up my cross, and follow him. I concluded that this is the life that's really worth living. I concluded that this is the story I want my life to tell. This is a story worth telling. But for you graduates here today, this is a great day for you. And as you leave Oakdale and open this next chapter in your story, in your life, what life will be worth living to you? Is it a life of comfort, worldly pleasure, a life that's lived just for you? Even though there are things and comforts in life that are, and things you want to strive for, and things you want to succeed at, all of that is great, and go for that. But I submit to you that in comparison to Christ, to who he is and what he's done, what he offers you, none of those things can compare. And I pray to God that you would gladly trade in any success for him if he asks that of you. To the future grads here, would other people praise God as a result of hearing your story? Would other people be thrilled to hear how you have lived your life for Christ? Is your story worth telling because you have forsaken all to follow Christ? I think about my wife, Hagar, who's here, and how she has faced persecutions and had her life threatened for the sake of Christ, and how she has left lands, how she has left career, how she has even left family for a time for the sake of Christ. This is the life that's worth living. If you're a Christian here today, you know that, and I feel the same, but you know that your story isn't a fairy tale. It isn't a squeaky clean, beautiful, picturesque story. Rather, it's possibly filled with deep regrets. You bear the scars of your own sins. But take courage that Christ can and has healed your wounds. He has freed you from your guilty verdict and ushered you into his kingdom. Take heart and know that your life, the life that you live, is worth living. And you have a story worth telling. To the graduates here, I hope and pray that you have hung on every word that I've spoken. That this life that Jesus talks about in Mark 8, that this is life that really is worth living. And if he calls you to, even worth dying for. So I submit to you, I charge you, go out and reach for the stars. Reach for the sky. But let Christ be all and everything in your life. And to all of you here today, whatever you do, wherever you're from, whoever you are, I submit to you to believe on this Jesus. Believe on him and trust in him for your salvation. Not your own self, not your family, not your pastor or your spiritual teacher, but in Christ, only he can save you. He saved me, the greatest of all sinners, and I give him glory for that. I want to say once again, congratulations to you guys. You guys are amazing, by the way. You guys look great. Thank you all for listening. Thank you all for your time. God bless.
Liberty Elizabeth Geddes. Isaiah Edward Johnson. Kyla Ito Jones. Brianne Rose Leah McWilliams. Rishat Bilshiktovich Sabatov. Ladies and gentlemen, the Oakdale Christian Academy class of 2015.
Sing the school song. In the present and beyond all time.